So in the last class, we have seen how to use a for loop, then how to use the range function. So why do you use the range function and how it can be used with a for loop? That's what we have discussed in the previous class, right? So range is used to generate a sequence of numbers. Maybe it takes two, three different arguments. So one, two, or three arguments. Any possibility you can use. So with one argument, so a sequence is generated starting from zero to that value. And if you use two arguments, then those numbers will be considered as start and stop. And if you use three arguments, then so first number is indicates the start value of your sequence, stop value indicates the end value of your sequence, and step value is the incrementation. So that's how a sequence will be generated, and it can be very convenient to use the range function with the for loops. Whenever you want to iterate through a sequence of numbers, you can use the range function with for loops. Of course, then we have discussed what is a break and what is continue and how it can be used with for and while loops. And in addition to that, we have seen what the assert statement is and how it can be used to ensure some conditions in the beginning of the program itself. You can use this assert condition. And in today's class, we will discuss some more additional things with the control structures. So Python provides some additional, properties with the control structures. So usually, where do you use the else condition? Else keyword, why do you use? Based on your C, C++, Java knowledge. Where do you use your else condition, else statement?
Right.
Huh? Hello. Tell me. Somebody is responding, but it was not clear. Please tell me. Why do you use the else condition, else statement? Hello. Am I audible to you? Yeah, then what is the problem? Why do you use else keyword in Python or in C? With the if condition only. If there is an if statement, then only you can use the else condition to ensure that whenever the condition is false, then you want to execute some other set of statements, you can use else block. That's how you use else block, right? But here, Python provides else with the loop control structures also. So with for loop and while loop also, you can use the else statement, and how it can be used we'll see in this class. Okay, so unlike C, C++, Java, no, Python provides a else statement or the else block, which you can associate them with the loops, like with the for loop and the while loop. And when you use them with the else block and the statements that you provide with the else block, they will be executed only when the loop is completely executed all the iterations. Remember the statement, when all the iterations, till the last iteration, if all the iterations are completed in your loop, then only your else block statements will be executed, either with a for or with a while. So of course, this the same way, usage is the same, but like you can use it with for and the while loop control structures. So these are the general forms. So with a for, what is the general form for loop? So for your index value in sequence of statements, the iterable, then the set of statements, right? And if you want to use that, use else with for, you can use it like this. So else followed by statements. And similarly with while also, you can use the else statement. So as usual, you write the while, and after the while, then you attach the else block. And what is the use? Why do you need to use this else block with the for and the while is? So to ensure that all the iterations in your for loop or the while loop are executed completely, to ensure that you will be using else. That is, so whenever the loop is completely successfully executed, then if you want to display or if you want to perform some set of statements, then you can put those statements in the else block. So that's how it can be used. Did you get anything out of that? Why do you use else?
Yes.
For or while? Yeah. So now let's see an example. So it can be used with for, it can be used with while also. So here I'm taking an example for value in range of 5. So what happens with this when you create range of 5? What happens with this? So a sequence will be generated. Yeah, with 0 to 4. Good. So then you are repeating the loop and printing that value. So every time you iterate over this loop, so the sequence will be generated, and every time a value will be copied to this VAL variable, and that value will be displayed. Right? So this is the common thing only. Then, so you are attaching the else block. So this else block you are displaying, the loop has completed execution. So once all the iterations are completed, are all the iterations are completed of this for loop or not successfully? In the last iteration, every iteration has completed, right? So to indicate that after completion of the loop, what you want to do, so that you can mention with the else block. Okay. So for that you can use can you ask me, can you remind me later, because I'm into the other topic. You should have asked me earlier. Ternary operator and assert keyword are the same, so please remind me at the after this topic is over. Okay, good question. So now where we are, so with for loop you can display as usual, and when you attach this else block, it ensures that so this for loop or the any loop condition loop executes all the iterations. So if that is done, then only this else part will be executed. So if you observe here, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, as usual, they will be displayed. And are all the iterations are executed or not? All the iterations are completely successfully executed, right? So will the else block be executed or not? Yes, right? So that's how this else block will be executed. The statement you are writing here is loop has completed execution. Okay, for that you are using. So if you want, no, you can do something else also. Okay, so then a small note is else block, when the else block will be executed, the loop completely executes all the iterations. Please remember that when the loop executes all the iterations, then only your else block will be executed. Now let's see another example. Now I have another example. I'm using the else block with for only, but I have changed my code. So here I have introduced a break statement. Okay, for value in range of 5, if value equal to 3, break, then print value, yes, this. Now, can you tell me all the iterations are completed in the for loop? In this example?
No, ma'am.
Right? Now, do you expect the else block to be executed in this case?
No, ma'am.
No, right? Yeah. Now, good. So that is how here the else block will not be executed. So because you are terminating the loop in between here itself. So because you have a break statement with value equal to 3. Whenever value is 3, then you are breaking this loop. That is, you are like terminating the loop completely. So till the last iteration, you're not allowing the loop to continue. So that's how, because the loop is not completely executed, so your else block will not be executed. So this else block, whenever you attach with a for or while, will be executed only when all the iterations till the last iteration all are completely executed. Now let's see with while. So how it is done with while. So now I have set of statements with while. Now can you tell me how this while loop executes? What is the expected output of this? Hello, this part, I'm not talking about else, only this part. What is the expected
zero
output?
To four.
0 to 4.
0 to 4, very good. So 0 to 4, okay. So, but what is the condition you are giving? I less than or equal to 5. Actually, the loop is broken in between. It's terminated, right? When I value is 5. So are all the iterations completed or you are broken in the middle?
Broken,
right? So do you expect the else block to be executed or not?
No, ma'am.
So that's how your output, if you observe, no, here you can see the expected output. So whatever is there in the else block, that is not printed. Okay, so that's how you can use the else statement with the while loop or with the for loop. Now let's see this example. Now I have the while loop. Okay, now I have the else statement with the while loop. A simple example. Now can you guess the output? What is happening here? So what is the output of the while loop?
0 to 5.
0 to 5. Yes. 0 to 5 and all the iterations are completely executed in the while loop. So that's how your else block will also be executed. So the loop has completely executed. This message will also be executed. So after completion of the loop, to indicate that successfully all the iterations are completed, so to indicate that you are using the else block. Okay? So whatever the statements you want, you can have that. Fine? So that's how you can use. Now let's see the demo of that. So you can see my code, right? All the windows are visible to you?
Yes, ma'am.
So now let's create one program. First we'll see the file. The same thing. What we are going to do? I equal to 0 while I less than 5. Maybe I less than or equal to 5. I'm going to repeat this loop for 5 times. From 0 to 5, 6 times. Then I'm just displaying print I. So I equal to I plus 1. Yeah, first let's see what is the output of this. You see? So you are using the while loop to display all the values from 0 to 5. So 0 to 5, all the values are displayed, right? Now I want to use a else block. Else print off. Successful termination of while loop. Now, can you guess the output?
0 to 5.
Yeah, 0 to 5. Yes, successful termination of while. Now, I am using a condition. If I value is 3, then I am including a break statement. Now, let's see. Can you guess? Can you guess the output?
0 to 2.
0 to 2. Whenever this 3, so it's breaking. That is, the loop is terminating. Because till the last iteration, all the iterations are not completed, the else block will also not be executed. That's how. So only 0, 1, 2. Now, let me continue with continue. Now, can you guess the output? What happens? What is the output? Zero to four, good. Next, will this statement be executed or not?
No.
No. Why? When the else block will be executed? Can you tell me that?
Till the last
iteration, all the iterations are completed or not? So till the last iteration, all the iterations are completed or not? In this example, are you not going till the last statement?
Going.
You are right. You are doing that. Because whenever I equal to 3, only these statements are not executed. Right? Next iteration will be done. Next iteration will be done. Next iteration will be done. Till the condition fails, all the iterations will be done. Right? So that's how your else block will be executed. Now let's see. What's happening? So 1, 2. Something is wrong. So I'm sorry for that. So I value was actually below this. Now let's see. So all the values will be displayed and so successful termination of the while statement. See, so even if this one of the statement is skipped also, that's not a problem because the condition is tested. Okay, every iteration you are going through. but just that you are skipping some of the statements. So because of this continue, this statement alone is skipped. Other than that, every iteration is repeated till the last statement. So that's how your while loop is successfully completed with all the iterations. That's why your else block will also be executed. So you got the point?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. Why I'm getting response only from few of the people. So the same with for loop also. So instead of while, the working is all the same. So instead of the while loop, you can use the for statement. Okay. Do you want me to show that or is it okay? Hello.
Yes, ma'am. No need, ma'am.
Okay, good. Some noise I'm getting from someone. Please mute yourself. Now let's proceed to the nested loop structures. So similar to your nested if conditions or nested conditional structures or the nested functions, we have the nested loop structures also, where one loop can be written inside the other. So one loop can be written inside of the other. Now why is lower? Why is it low?
It's audible.
Okay, good. So maybe the problem is from your side, Amruta. Please check that. It's fine with me. So now we are discussing nested loop structures where one loop can be placed inside the other loop structure. So now if you observe, this is the general form you can have. So here I'm writing a for loop. This is what the for loop is. And inside this for loop, I have these set of statements. So as part of that, one of the statements could be your for loop also, or while loop also, or if condition also. So that's how a loop is embedded inside the other loop. So this is called as a nested loop. The same is holding good for the while loop also. So inside one while loop, you can have another while loop or another for loop also. So such kind of structures, loop structures are called as nested loop structures, where you are nesting one loop inside the other loop. Fine. So that's how you can use it. Now let's see an example how it can be used. So here I'm just using, let me show me the example. That would be better, I feel. So I am just creating two. What was the example? The same values. So simply I'm writing for I in, maybe I'm taking a list. 20, 30, 40. So this is my outer loop. Now I'm taking J. It's another loop. Maybe the values are different. We'll take different values. 101, 201, 401. Now J. Print that. My value is something like this, comma I, comma. So can you guess what will be the output of this? You have done this in your C language also. But how simple it would be. Now, later I'll show you how simply you can do this actually. Yeah, please guess the outputs. What is happening here? So you are iterating your outer for loop. So this is called as outer for loop. This is called as inner for loop. So when you have one for loop inside the other, so you can call it like this. And this kind of hierarchy nesting can be done to any number of levels actually. So here you have this for loop, outer for loop, and this is the for loop that is embedded inside that loop, right? So this you can call it as inner loop, and this you can call it as outer loop. Okay, and you are iterating through a loop, a sequence. So where the first value will be placed in I here. So 10 will be assigned to I first. Then with that I value, so you are repeating this entire loop. So what happens with this for loop? So this 101. So those I and J values will be displayed. So what value will be displayed? In the first iteration, what will be displayed?
I will 10 and not 1.
10 and not 1.
Very good. Okay, next. Next
10, 2, not 10, 1.
2, not 1. 1.
Very good. 10 with 2, not 1. 10 with 3, not 1. Because, so the inner loop will be completing all the iterations. Once that is done, then only the outer loop value will be incremented. Right? So you know that very well, of course. So that's how the nested for loops will be executed. So for the sample output, you can have a look at this. So if you observe, no? So first 10 value, the outer loop value will be assigned to I. Then with that I value, every value of the inner loop will you are displaying. So that's what we have written code for that. So 20 is displayed with 101, 201, 301, 401. Then 30 with the same 101, 201, 301, 401. So similarly 40 with all these values. So that's how you can use a nested loops wherever it is required. So now I'll just give you some of the tips which can be useful for you when you are using the Python loops. Okay. So maybe with these kind of tips, no, you can very easily write your some of the complex codes. So now let's see the first tip. So you can actually create a sequence with a for loop also. So say for example, I'm asking you to find square for every number. So like I'm asking you to read some set of values, then you need to find square of every number, n values. How do you do? Tell me that. Did you get my question?
We use nested for loop, ma'am.
Yeah, nested for loop for what? Nested is not required actually, no. One single for loop itself will be enough. So now let me show that I'm going to use even program is not required. Shell itself, I'll do this because it's simple. So now I have a list of values. Assume I have a list of values like 1, 2, 3, 4 like this. I have a list of values. Now I'm going to find, I want you to find a square of every number or square root maybe. So any operation, square, square root or division of that, of every element in this loop, in this list. How do you do that? So you need to repeat a loop, right? The same way I'll be repeating a loop, but how I'll do that is I'll do it in a simple way. Where is it? Here. Yeah. So I for I in L1. See? If you want, you can display squares now. So see, every element. Or maybe I will make it much simpler than this. So L1 also I'll not be creating range of 0, comma, which numbers? Maybe some 10 numbers five. I create. Yeah, 5, okay, 5 or 10, whatever it is. 5 already we are done with that. So when you have lot of numbers, no, it will be very easy for you. See, even for 100 numbers also I can do that easily. That simple it is. And I'm printing squares. See? So with single statement itself, you are doing this lot of code. So you understand? So in Python, it's very simple and it's very convenient. Very compactly, you can write most of the complex stuff. So what is happening here? So now let's try to understand. So here, what is happening? I am creating a list. So L1 with the elements 1, 2, 3, 4. So that's very familiar to all of you. So then here I'm going to create a list using the for loop. So for loop can be basically used to create new lists also. So that's what the tip I'm sharing with you. So here how I'm doing that is for I in L1. So this is how we write the for loops, right? Usually for the index value in the sequence list. So till here it's the same, but because you are going to create a list, you know, whatever the value you want to repeat, that you need to place it here. Usually, how do you write your for loops? Tell me, if you want to write that in the for loop, how do you write that? So for I in range of maybe 0, 10, here you will be writing print of or. So if you want to assign to list, no, it is little complex. All those functions I'll be explaining later, but usually this is how we do. So you need at least two statements just to display itself. But if you want to add it to the list and if you want to display that, it requires two more statements. And all those functions you don't know as of now, that's why I cannot explain. So this is how we'll do that. But instead of having multiple statements, you can write everything in a single statement. So whatever the value operation you want to perform, and that you can write it here, and later you place the for loop here. And when you read the statement, how do you how you should interpret that is, so start reading from here for I in L1, and your values will be of I into I. For every value I in this list L1, you are creating a value I into I. So do you understand what is happening here?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. So that's how every for every value of L1, for 1 you will be getting 1 into 1. That's how you got 1. So for 2 you will be getting 2 into 2. So that's how you got 4. Similarly 9, similarly 16. And if you have more numbers, that will be repeated till the last number. So that's how you can get the square of every element in your list with a single statement itself. Basically, for loop can be used to create new sequences also. Any doubt so far? So for some of you, if you feel that it is too complex, you need not to worry about this, because I told you at the beginning of the class itself, actually second unit is completed. It's done with the syllabus. But just out of my interest, and for those who are interested in programming, I'm sharing all these. Okay. So, and now let's see the next one. So actually you can iterate over two different lists using this single for loop itself. So here, if you observe, where did we use nested for loops? Yeah, here I have written the nested loop, right? So here I have two different loops, loop one and loop two. And if you want to iterate over these two loops, so you are writing two different for loops. But instead of doing that, you can do that with a single for loop itself if you want to iterate over multiple sequences, multiple lists. Now let's see how we can do that. So let's copy the same code instead of typing. Or you want me to type, maybe for your understanding, I'll type it. So I'm taking one list where your ID numbers, your roll numbers form one list, okay? And names of the students. So first one in first list indicates your roll numbers, and second list indicates your names, Ram, Raj, something like this. Then maybe some Ravi, next some Raku. So these are the names of the students, IDs of the students. We have four students and four roll numbers. Now I want to display the IDs along with the names, and I want to use only one for loop. Of course, you know how to do that with two different for loops, right? Nested for loops you can use, but you can use that with single for loop itself. So what you can do is for I comma j in zip of, so you have a function called as zip function, and we'll see how this function works a little later, but as of now you can understand. So print of ID value, ID of the student is, or ID value is something like this, comma, what you want to display, what do you need to display here? Where is ID name. Value? I, right? ID. ID is, where is it? It's in IDs. Now let's continue with the names. Name value is, so where is the name? This is in
J.
Very good, very good. Let's see. So I have used only one single for loop, if you understand, right? But I am able to iterate over multiple lists. I am able to get this value and this value, where these values are from different lists also. And I'm able to repeat all the values from both the lists. So how is it done? You can use the zip function. So zip function, what it does is, we'll see that later when we discuss functions. But as of now, this is you remember, this is how you can iterate over two different loops. And this can be extended to any number of sequences. It need not to be two. So maybe you can have one more, maybe marks. So if you have marks as another list, you can have marks also. Marks one, marks two, something like that. You can extend that to any number of sequences. So is that fine? Do you understand how you iterate through different sequences at the same time?
Yes,
using a single for loop.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, good. So now let's see the one important tip you have to remember is, so you'll be doing this kind of loop errors. So I have shown one right today. So you design a loop, but the while loop especially, you are not giving any incrementation, or the index value you are not incrementing, and you are repeating this. What happens when you execute this? What happens? You are trapped into the infinite loop, and you will not realize that. So whenever you design these kind of loops, no, you should be little careful. And one more suggestion is, or maybe a tip. So you can even convert this regular kind of loops, your for loop, into the C style for looping also. Now let's see how do we convert that. So basically, you know, your for loops you are writing in your Python are different. So if you observe, maybe I have only L1 as a list. How do you write if you want to display these values? Can someone prompt? Value is I. So this is how we write in a normal way in Python. But if it is in C programming, how do you do? So if you want to iterate across the array, how do you write the code? Can you tell me? I have an array A and I have n elements. How do you repeat the loop? Do you remember? Hello. C++, Java.
For I equal to 0, I less than n, I plus plus.
Very good.
Print A of I.
Yeah, A of I, something like that, right? Based on the index. We'll use the index display. In Python also, basically, we can do that. So how we can do that? Let's see. So what we can do is, I want to extract the value from the using the index. So for that, you can use range of length of L1. Okay, so what is happening here? So what this length of L1 returns? Do you remember?
4.
4, very good. And what is this range of 4 returns? Range of
0 to 3.
0 to 3, very good. Now, so I'm getting every time, what value I'll be getting into I first?
0.
Next?
1. Next.
2, 3. Yeah, good. So now, if I display I value, what will be displayed? Let's see what will be displayed. See, the index values will be displayed, but I want to display the values in the list. How do I do that? I can use that as an index. Can I use that or not?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. So this is how you can use the C style of looping also. That is also possible. Okay. And one more thing is, you can use the enumerate function also. What is happening? I am getting response only from very few students. One student or two students I am getting. Now and then from the second student. Otherwise, so throughout the class, I'm getting response only from one student. This is very bad. So is there anything going wrong? So are you able to follow the class or not? So now let's see the enumerate function. So which will be very much useful for you. So how you can use the enumerate function. So now let's see that. So what this enumerate function is, so in detail I'll explain these later, but as of now, let's see how you can use it. So I value and value. So what this enumerate function, when you pass a list or the tuple to this, is, so it generates a tuple of values like 0, 101, 1, 102, 2, 103, that is with the index, with the value, list will be generated. Then, so when you repeat over the for loop, the enumerate over the for loop, then so first index will get the index value and the second variable will get the actual value of this list. Maybe once I display, you can understand. I comma value. So value is this. See, you are getting the index values and also the values 101, 102, 104, up to 104. Fine. That's how you can use the. You can use what?
The enumerate.
What is happening when you use the enumerate with the list?
We can both index values and their values are displayed.
Exactly. So index values and the values in that sequence both can be used. So maybe that is what for today's class. So you can take this assignment. So one thing is you can write a program to print a table also, multiplication table. Write a Python program to generate multiplication table. So please take this assignment and show me tomorrow. Do we have class tomorrow? I hope we have. Nalida?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. So please solve these questions and come back to me tomorrow. So someone had a question, right? Who was that, Amruta or someone else? So let me explain that question. Is ternary operator a set keyword? So how do you use ternary operator? Can you tell me? Who is this 399 name? Name of that person?
Janardhan.
Janardhan, very good. So good question, Janardhan. So do you remember how ternary operator can be used?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, how do you use?
Means if one statement is true, means it will execute, or it is false, means second statement will execute, ma'am.
So maybe it's something like this, if A greater than B, colon, or what is that? How do you use that? Question, huh?
Question mark.
Yeah, question mark. And here, so if the condition is true, whatever the statements that is after this. So maybe yes, something ma'am. Like A is big, something like this. Otherwise, print off.
A is big, like.
Yeah, something like this. So of course, this is not valid in Python, but I'm just, for the explanation, I'm writing here. So if A is greater than B, this condition is true, then, so whatever the statement that you write after this question mark, that will be executed. But if the condition is false, then the statement will be executed. Right? That's how? There is no if actually. So this is how the ternary operator works. But how the assert statement works, do you remember?
So the statement is valid.
Let me open that. I believe I have that. So we have seen that, right? So assert. So Esther, you are checking this condition, and if this is true, then your statements. Oh, this is not correct actually. Open. This example. Yeah. So with assert, you are just using the condition. So if the condition is true, then only your rest of the program will execute. It's nothing like execute this or execute that. It's not like that. It's like if this condition holds, then your rest of the program will be executing. I'm not talking about this condition. So even if you have some additional set of statements, I'm talking about the whole program itself.
Okay.
This based on this condition, your entire program execution so will be depending. So.
Okay.
Did I answer your question?
Yes, ma'am. Understood.
Yeah. Good. Thank good, Janardhan. Very good. Yeah. So now we'll stop with this. Second unit is over. So if you have any doubts, so please raise. So maybe in tomorrow's class or even now after this class also, I'll take if you have any questions. So you can either personally ask me or you can even ask me in the class. And if you don't practice whatever you are doing, it's all waste. Remember. So mere theory will never help you. Okay. You have to practice the things.
Assignment questions in the group.
Assignment questions. I want. You want me to share?
Yes, ma'am. In group.
Yeah, I'll share that. No problem. Questions. Any questions? I'm always interested to take questions. So that's the only indication that people are doing something. Something interesting. This is fifth R. Is it fifth R?
Sixth.
Sixth, sir? Okay. So why only 108 students joined the class? There should be around 115, right? Where is the 16 batch guy? Is absent? 1, 2, 3. 40 is present. 3, then 5, 6. 14 is present, 22. Any questions on the topics covered so far? 20, 29. Yeah, please try to be interactive in the classes. That is how you can make yourself focused on the classes. And that gives a lot of energy to me also. So if you are quiet in the class, I'll not be getting any interest to teach you. Practice. Programming is the only thing that will help you. So you understand everything, and if you don't practice, means it's all waste only. So go back, open your systems, practice the things, and you can solve the problem. You can practice in HackerRank platforms. Any one of you are trying? 163, 164, 167, 69, 171, 76, 79.